Well, something wicked this way done came. Have you seen the markets lately? I thought I'd take a time out to comment on the recent market volatility before our regularly scheduled show. On Friday, we saw the S&P 500 and the Dow Jones Industrial Average down about 2%, closing about the low. And then on Monday, we saw them both down around 4%, with the Dow Jones Industrial Average closing down 1,000 points. That's a pretty scary print. And then Tuesday, hey, let's talk about Tuesday. Actually, let's not, because it's Monday afternoon when I'm recording this, and I don't know what happened Tuesday. But I think we should comment on this market volatility, because it can be scary, especially if you turn on the financial news. Now, a market correction is defined as about a 10 to 15% drop from recent highs. Well, we're only down about 5 or 6% from the high that we just hit not that long ago. And although we've given her back a lot of ground, we're still at the levels of right before the year started, 2018. So we haven't even had a market correction yet. And they should happen about every 18 months, and we haven't seen one in a while. So this is par for the course, but it's still scary. Now, if you are near or entering or in retirement, this does take on a little bit more importance because you're entering that phase where you're slowing down the accumulation of more assets, where every market downturn just gave you the opportunity to buy at lower prices, to a period of time when your longevity is still pretty long and you may be taking money out of your investment portfolios. So it's critical that you have an appropriate risk level for your unique situation. Now, back in episode 200, we started a series on doing a market correction fire drill that over a couple weeks, we walked through step by step things you can do to make sure that you're taking the appropriate amount of risk or working to take the appropriate count of risk for your situation. So if you haven't done so already, you might want to go check that out and make sure that you're prepared for a market correction so you can make decisions based on your situation and not simply the emotions of seeing that red all over the stock market tracker. So go check that out. Now let's get on with our regularly scheduled program.
Are you ready to make the most of the only life you have? To make smart money choices focused on achieving what you care about most? Here to help you balance living well today without sacrificing your tomorrow is the Retirement Answer Man, Roger Whitney.
I got a buddy who for the last 15 plus years has had a regular Friday route delivering meals to elderly people every Friday. So every Friday for 15 years, he'll go pick up his meals for the day and drive house to house on his route to deliver food to people that have a hard time getting out of their house, generally very elderly people. The stories he tells of many times his visit on that Friday afternoon is the only outside interaction many of these people have. They don't get around much. They have family far away. And so he makes sure to spend time knowing their names, asking how they are, checking out the house to make sure things are going okay, to give them some social interaction. He's a special guy because there are a lot of lonely people in retirement. How do you not be one of them? We're going to talk about that in our Hot Topic segment right after this all-important disclaimer. Hey, week to week, you should never take advice from me on this show. This is helpful hints and education. I only give advice to clients, but I'm going to tell you something, especially this week, because I have a wicked sinus infection and I'm a little drugged up on antihistamines and decongestants and steroids and everything else. So that's why I sound so funny. But definitely don't take advice from me on this day, if any day. Before you make any decisions, talk to your legal advisor, your tax advisor, or your financial advisor, because that's just common sense. Now let's go figure out how to avoid loneliness. Loneliness can kill you at worst, and at best, greatly degrade the quality of your life in retirement. According to the U.S. Census Bureau, 11 million people over 65 and older, about 28% of them, live alone. Another study shows that 3.9 million older people view TV as their main source of company. 17% see family and friends less than once a week. 1 in 10 go a month or longer without company. So what's the impact of this? A recent study from the University of York in Great Britain found that lonely people are 30% more likely to suffer a stroke or heart disease, two of the leading causes of death. Harvard University found that people with no friends has a linkage between increased levels of blood clotting protein, which can cause these heart attacks and strokes. It's been found that lonely people had a 50% increased risk of early death compared to those with good social connections. So compare that to obesity, which rises the chance of early death before the age of 70 by about 30%. You could argue that loneliness is more impactful to someone's risk of dying early than obesity. Loneliness can increase mortality rates. It could hasten the decline of cognitive skills. Here are some of my observations over the last 27 years. One is lack of work routine. You know, work has this built-in social aspect where you're going in meetings, you're sitting next to people, you're traveling together, you're interacting on a day-by-day basis. And they may not be the people you would have chosen necessarily, but it gives you a social network to foster relationships. And when you retire, if you're not intentional about it, that can go away and you cannot create that during retirement. Another cause of loneliness is the loss of a spouse. I see many people when they retire, they don't build the social network that they lost in work, but they do have a great social network with their spouse. And they spend a lot of time traveling together, doing hobbies together, doing things they enjoy together. And it becomes very one-on-one focused, even if you have a few couple friends that are around. But then when one spouse dies, that focus on the other significant other that you've been with for decades can really come back and bite you, because then you can find yourself all alone, older, without the skills and the muscles to renew friendships and build social connection. Another thing that contributes is transportation challenges, whether that's being able to travel in a car or on a plane. As we get older, we can have things that will make it more difficult to get around, which can cause us to become more isolated. Another thing that couples with that is physical challenges. Sometimes physical challenges can beat us down mentally to where, one, we may not just be able to get out near as easily. It's too big of a production. Or more insidious and secret is we're just slowing down. We ache more. We're less optimistic. And so we make lots of little choices to go the easy route so we don't get out and maintain or build social connections. Another one is, you know, that family or friends that you have early in retirement that can make it so awesome. Well, a lot of those people can move away or they can pass away, because most people I know that are in retirement have friends that are right around their age or older, which can cause us to slowly become the last person standing. All of these things can contribute to loneliness, and it doesn't matter your net worth, how rich your fabric is today. The older you get, the more intentional we need to be about maintaining and fostering our social connections. So what are some things that you and I can do to combat this? So let's go through some things. One thing you can do at the start, though, is if you go back and listen to episode 166. On that episode, I have an interview with Dan Miller from 48 Days to the Work You Love. And I'm going to have him on the show, he and his wife, Joanne, who have been together for 50 years, here in the coming weeks when we talk about marriage and love, because it's February. And on that interview, or that talk that we have with Dan, he talks a little bit about his social network. But let me give you a quick recap. Dan is 70 years old, and he has the most vibrant, spirited personality and social network that I've ever seen. He and Joanne are very intentional about building relationships all across the world through his blog and his 48 Days network and Joanne's blog. I mean, I'm 51 and I count Dan as one of my dearest friends. Dan has been very intentional about building a social network of people, not just his age, but of people younger than him. And Joanne has too. And they're my rabbit. I want to be like them when I'm that old because I see how much more alive they are compared to people that don't. So you can check out that talk on episode 166. But what are some things you can do today to start to be more intentional about building your social network? Well, number one is you can continue to build new relationships with peers, people your age, that have similar interests. That makes sense, right? That could be joining a club, going to a conference, going to a meetup, finding ways to interact with other people. Now, some of that takes some social courage. Now, I tend to not have an issue showing up by myself to a trivia night at the local barbecue place and just sitting down and joining a team and making friends. Now, that may be difficult for you. So it may require some courage and intentionality to find a baby step, to find organizations, whether it's a book club, a meetup, trivia night, classes at Home Depot or Michael's Crafts, whatever floats your boat, to purposely play in traffic and be open to new relationships. It takes some time. Another thing you can do, number two, is build connections younger than you. Now, that might seem a little hard sometimes. You're so old and wise now. What would a young person, a 50, 45-year-old, want to do with you? Well, I'll tell you. If you're alive and you're an active thinker, you have a lot of wisdom that the right people crave. And they got a lot of spunk and creativity that might be able to do you some good too. So building networks down, that could be through mentoring. That could be volunteering as a coach. It could be teaching classes on something that's of interest to you. It could be volunteering. It could be through the church. But just because someone's 10, 15, 20, 30 years younger than you doesn't mean they can't be your friend and that they don't have an interest in you. So don't close that off because they're probably going to be around through your entire life. So that might come in helpful, right? Third, you can cultivate your purpose. Now, I see this as a big one, and that's one reason why most people, when they go towards retirement, they're running away from something, and they don't think about what they're running to. And then they, after the honeymoon period of retirement, start to drift around without really understanding what they're around for. They no longer have a mountain to charge, a reason to get up in the morning, and that can lead to melancholy, which can lead to depression, and all of those can lead to isolation. Just because you retire from full-time work doesn't mean you don't have a reason to get up and a purpose for your life. How do you find that? By intentionality and taking little steps to cultivate what that could be. It goes back to intentionality. And then lastly, how do you combat this loneliness? Is you're going to have to become someone that embraces change management. And that can be harder as we get older. But regardless of what age you are, the one constant is going to be change. So it comes back down to what can you control and freeing the things that you can't control. Well, I can't control this disability I have, this old injury, but I can do this to go meet new people. Now, for me right now, as an example, and this is a really weak example maybe, but I can't run anymore. I love running, and I was at a board retreat this last week, and a bunch of my cohorts were going for a morning run. I would have loved to have joined them, but I can't because of my knee. I have to cycle or do yoga, do other things. So my choice is I could be depressed about that or embrace the change and figure out ways to play in traffic based on what I'm able to do. Now, one last thing I want to say about loneliness is I see people of all ages, even in their 90s, they're the most vibrant people I've ever seen. It doesn't have to be that way, but it comes down to being intentional about fostering those relationships. Because if you're not intentional, it can sneak up on you. And the beauty is today, and I've seen this for myself in the last 4 or 5 years through doing this podcast, I now have more good friends all over the country than I do locally. My friends span the entire country, and some live overseas. Another good buddy I have lives in Jerusalem, and we speak on a monthly basis. So the barriers have come down because of technology. So the pool that you can find friends in doesn't have to be in your local community. You can get on Zoom calls. You can do virtual meetups. You can go to conferences. There's lots you can do. But I want to encourage you, as we think about relationships in this month of February, that regardless of where you're at right now and how vibrant your social network is, be intentional about keeping it that way. All right, let's go answer some listener questions in the practical planning segment. Hey, welcome to the practical planning segment where we answer some of your listener questions. Hey, Nicole, how are you doing today? Nicole? Hey, Nicole, you there? Wait, let me text her. Did she forget when we were recording? Hold on. What? Nicole has decided to take a pass on this week's question and answer because she, get this, she is afraid of catching my sinus infection over the internet. That girl is so paranoid. Okay, we'll march on without her. So the first thing I want to do is clarify something that I said in a prior show. I was talking about tracking non-deductible contributions, and I made a boo-boo. And a gentleman pointed it out in an email, and I can't recall your name, and I couldn't find the email. But the best way to track your non-deductible contributions, if you're making non-deductible contributions to an IRA, let me back up a second, you want to make sure you track those, because if you mix them with deductible contributions, a portion of that money, you've already paid taxes on it. So if you don't track it, it might be very difficult to not pay taxes on again when you're taking money out 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now. So if you're mixing deductible contributions to an IRA, which is contributing money to an IRA and taking a tax deduction, along with non-deductible contributions, you're going to want to keep track of those so you don't pay more tax than you need to. And this fine gentleman pointed out that you can file each year an IRS form, it's form 8606, with your tax return that notifies the IRS, hey, I made these non-deductible contributions. So the IRS knows that and you have it on record. So way down the line, when you start to take money out, you don't pay more tax than you need to on money you've already paid taxes on. So thank you so much for that clarification. You are exactly right. Now, we got one of our young listeners, Joe, asking me about Merriman's ultimate buy-hold allocation. So Paul Merriman is a prolific blogger on investment management and super nice guy and pretty smart. And he has these ultimate buy-and-hold allocations. And Joe wants to know, he says, hey, I'm 25 and I'm currently implementing the portfolio number 7 on the chart below. And if I pull that up, it's basically, let's see here, let me pull it up here. All equities across the board in 10% buckets. You have 10% in the S&P and then small cap value and REITs and international and so on and so forth. And he wants to know what I think about that as a buy and hold strategy for a youngin. Well, obviously, I can't give you, Joe, a specific recommendation. I think it's probably adequate enough if you're very long-term and you're focused only on wealth accumulation and you understand the volatility that you're signing up for. Is it correctly allocated? Well, that's always a debate for everybody. Everybody has their own way of doing anything. The key is, are you comfortable with it and do you understand what you're signing up for from a risk-return profile in the accounts that you're using? So I'm not going to bash it, but I'm not going to say it's bad either. You're young, and if this is 30-plus year money and you're allocating money to it consistently over time and you have cash reserves, so this is truly long-term money, it may not be all bad. Whether it's better than something else, it's too hard to tell. So hopefully it helps you a little bit. Now, Brian asked a question about this managed payout fund. I guess it's something that Vanguard has. And Brian, it's really hard to answer questions about specific investments such as this. And you're asking, hey, I'm 32 years old. I got two kids, 150 gross income, no debt except the house, currently investing extra payments in a total market return type of investment with the hope to outpace your mortgage. Is this a safe bet? I don't know. I don't know enough about you. But here's some ways to think about this, Brian. One is, I definitely wouldn't use something that's structured for automatic payouts for someone in your situation. Because you're nowhere near that level at 32 years old would be my guess. I'm assuming this is 10, 20, 30 year plus money. What I would suggest that you consider is go through the checklist of, okay, how much cash reserves do I need for emergencies? Have I paid off all the bad debt? Do I have reserves for extraordinary expenses? For example, a car. If you have a car that you know you're saving for, I wouldn't invest that. I would build that money up in addition to your normal cash reserves if your objective is to pay cash for that car, unless you're talking, you know, 5-8 years out. I definitely wouldn't invest it in something thinking that you can withdraw money when you have that big purchase, because that money will be at risk. And it could really be good for you because you get the returns, but it also could really bite you if you happen to need the money after a big sell-off. So I would go look at it from a balance sheet perspective. And then when you get down to your quote-unquote true investment assets, then you can find the allocation that is long-term and appropriate for you. So I wouldn't mess around with trying to eke out any potential return even on your cash reserves. I would look at it from a balance sheet perspective. And then the last thing I want to get to today, because I'm barely awake with this sinus infection, is Gail, a longtime listener, gave me some comments on mortgages and buying a house that I thought I would pass along because I don't think I've ever talked about this. So she has a paid for condo, a super high credit score, and about $1 million in saving and investments. And she wanted to buy another house before selling her condo so she could take her time moving and not get stuck without a house, right? But when she went through the mortgage process to get like a $250,000 loan, even with $200,000 down, so a $400,000 house, they didn't want to do it, even though she had the assets to buy the house outright. There were no guaranteed income sources because she was retired and her Social Security had not started yet, and she didn't have a pension. See, mortgage companies, generally speaking, they look at you from an income perspective, meaning that regardless of how much money you have in the bank, they're looking at the income sources, the quote-unquote guaranteed income sources, work income, pension income, Social Security income, and qualifying you for a mortgage based on those income sources, regardless of how much money you have in the bank. Crazy, isn't it? I had a client once who was buying a $1.5 million house and had a net worth, a lot of it liquid, well over $5 million. Couldn't get a mortgage because he didn't have the income sources to qualify for the mortgage. So if you're looking at getting a mortgage close to retirement, you may want to consider how you do that while you still have your work income, because that's going to help you greatly in qualifying. Another option is to find a company that will do what's called manual underwriting. And they're pretty rare, but basically what they do is rather than just throw your financials into a calculator and let it spit out yes or no, they actually look at your balance sheet, get to know you, understand the history, and make a judgment from a person perspective rather than a calculator perspective. So great call out, Gail. I don't know if I've ever mentioned that. And that's a big issue when people are thinking about relocating during retirement. So it's something you might want to look out for. All right, let's go talk about the Happy Lab. Hey, welcome to the Happy Lab, where we noodle on how to live a happier life. So about 4 or 5 years ago, business-wise, very successful. Well, I wasn't that happy. I felt like it was Groundhog Day, and everybody around me was very comfortable doing exactly the same thing, and they weren't aspiring to do other things. They weren't lifting me up. Good friends. I still have many of them today. But over the last 4 or 5 years, I became very intentional about rebuilding my network and my purpose to grow as a man, as a husband, as a father, as an advisor, and as a business. Flash forward 5 or so years today, I have a vibrant social network. Many of you I get to converse with via email and phone, and friends literally all over the country. And I never have been happier or felt more alive than ever before. So even if you find yourself stuck, you don't have to stay that way. The question is, what's the one little baby step you can do to start rebuilding your network so you can have a vibrant social life?
On your marks, get set.
Hey, welcome to the Smart Sprint segment where we set a little baby step to creating a great retirement. So this week we're talking about loneliness. So your Smart Sprint for this week is to take an inventory in the next 7 days of your social network. How many friends do you have? How often do you see them? And then set one Smart Sprint to increase your social interactions so you can meet new people. As an example, I'm looking at my full focus planner right now. One of the goals I have this year, which say it got rescheduled for January, so I missed that one. But one of the goals I have this year is to host a monthly game night from January to June. January, we had it scheduled. People had to back out. So I failed there, but doesn't mean I'm going to give up. I'm going to host a monthly game night once a month. That's why it's called monthly. Oops. Drugs kicking in. Where I can meet a friend that I already know and have him bring a buddy or two so we can cultivate some friends that enjoy the same types of things. So that's an example of one. My question is, what are you going to do? Are you ready to rock retirement? Well, a good first step is to buy the Rock Retirement book on Amazon Kindle or Nook. One, the reviews have been good. It gets a little worrisome when you write something and you wonder what people are going to say. But if you read the reviews on Amazon so far, people seem to like it and it's approachable. It's not your boring finance book. But that could be a step. Buy the Kindle. Leave an honest review. I'll send you a hard copy signed. You want to know if I have extras? I got about 1,000 or 1,500 more extras around. And we're coming up on 100 reviews. It would be awesome to have 100 reviews. That's my selfish reason why to do it. But the real reason is I think it could help you be more intentional about creating a great retirement. So if you'd like a free paperback book, go to Amazon, go to Barnes & Noble, Nook, or wherever you buy your ebooks. Buy one, leave an honest review, and I'll send you a free paperback if you email me that you did. Okay, looking forward to talking to you next week when I feel healthy. And hopefully Nicole won't be such a scaredy cat and she'll come back next week. Until then, be well.
We appreciate you joining us today for this episode of Retirement Answer Man. Be sure to visit rogerwhitney.com/answers to access the Retirement Answer Library with over 30 checklists to help you make the most of the only life you have. Remember, you have more power than you realize to create an amazing life starting today with Retirement Answer Man. The opinions voiced in this material are for general information only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations for any individual. All performance referenced is historical and no guarantee of future results. All indices are unmanaged and may not be invested into directly. Have a wonderful day.